Let's not waste much time. This is part 3 of the key verification reverse engineering from Ponent Venture 3. And so, if you want to know more about how we got here, you should watch the previous videos. Our input is now in this 15-byte buffer. So, let's have a look what happens here. This obfuscated function here is very prominent, CJPQTPNW. It also appears to take three parameters, a constant, maybe a length again, the buffer with our input, but then also an unknown address. We know it's an address or pointer that is passed to the function because of LEA, load effective address. So let's check out that function. Oh, this is very similar to the memset we reverse engineered in the last video, but there are a few more lines here. We have a very obvious for loop again because the loop variable is initialized here with 0. Then we have the condition here with smaller than the value coming from here, and then here's the increment plus 1. And the value that is compared in the condition is coming from here, so edx, and that was our constant passed as a parameter. So yeah, that is a length. Our buffer was RSI, and the unknown new buffer was RDI. And inside the loop, we see the address of our buffer being loaded, then a byte loaded from an offset based on the loop iterator. Then we load the new buffer address and write the byte to it. And the rest was the for loop increment. So what well-known function is implemented here? This is obviously memcopy. Cool. So our input buffer is simply copied here. So this function performs several memcopies. Disassemblers offer various features for you to make the assembler code slowly understandable. I'm sure you know of IDA's Hexray's decompiler, for example, which is totally awesome and super helpful, but that doesn't exist for every architecture and doesn't produce great code every time. So it's good to practice with just having the assembler. You can always go to more advanced tools later, but if you only use those, then you won't really get the good feeling for the low-level stuff. Also, these tools are super expensive, while something like Hopper or Binary Ninja are pretty affordable, or even Radare, which is free. So of course, disassembler have the feature to add comments. You can press semicolon to add one, and we can basically write here pseudocode of what we just learned. Binary Ninja also has another pretty cool analysis feature, and that is the intermediate language. It has several different views for those in the options, and some of those produce pseudo-like code on various levels of analysis. So let's look at some. So this is low-level IL. You can see that instead of the assembler instructions, you get these assignments instead, which is maybe nicer for you to read. You can also see if only bytes or whole D words are used. Then there is medium IL. This even has a few more analysis and understands parameters for functions here. It figured out that it takes 3. And it also has created some default variables based on the registers used in the assembler and also adds some types. Let's work with that. That is pretty close to what we did in Python last time. So let's start by going through the code, then renaming some stuff. We can also give it types. We know the size of the buffers from the length of the memcopy, which is 12. Oh, 12 characters? This is interesting because we know that our buffer is actually 15 bytes long, so it only copies the first 12 bytes. And that buffer is later used in this function here. This function takes a lot of parameters. But what does this next construct mean here? We don't know what var7c is or var70. Let's go back to the assembler view and try to understand this. We can open the built-in console in Binary Ninja to do a quick calculation. Hex74 minus hex5f to see how far away those buffers are. But 21 is larger than the buffer, so this is not pointing inside of this buffer. And the other new buffer we know here, hex80, so hex80 minus 74, that's 12. This address seems to be its own new buffer address. But this one here, 75, points to the last character of this new 12-byte buffer. It takes the char, and it with 3, so it only keeps the lower 2 bits, and moves it back into the 12th last character. If we look at the medium IL view again, we also understand this now. Here the last character is taken and directly ended with 3, and here it is moved back. Okay, now we have here a second memcopy. This time only 4 bytes are copied. But what are these two buffers? I mean, the one is the destination and thus empty, but the other one is the source and should have content. Again, medium IL is not very helpful here, so let's go back to assembler. So RSI and RDI are typically used for source and destination. So this buffer is the destination. And the source here is coming from this add, and RSI before was our input buffer. It adds hex B, so 11 to it. This is the source. So here it copies the last 4 bytes from our buffer, offset 11, 12, 13 and 14. RSI and RDI are again just used by memcopy, and it copies 4 bytes. But before the memcopy, the 4 bytes are loaded in EAX, shifted by 2 to the right and moved back. And then it's loaded again, XORed with hex 2 bad code and moved back. And then we do the memcopy, so we copy that result into the destination buffer. Next we load the address of where the string PwnAdventure 3 is stored into RSI. So it's again the source of a memcopy. Here the destination is loaded, which is the new buffer that contains the XORed result from before, but then adds 4 to it. So we move the index after the XORed bytes from before, and then we copy the 7 new bytes after it. Cool. Now it's getting interesting. We load a lot of constants now. So this seems to be a single null byte. But then afterwards are all consecutive bytes. So this is initializing a buffer. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, A, B, C, D, E, F, A, 0, 12 bytes. And these three also belong together. Those bytes look fairly random, so I call this buffer random buffer for now, and down here I call it 101. And then we call sjnuahg, another obfuscated function. And then we call sjnuahg, another obfuscated function. If we switch to medium IL again, we see how many parameters it takes. That looks like a serious function, and based on the variables we named before, we can also see now which parameters are passed to it. It takes 4 constants, an empty new buffer, and our buffer that is filled with data from our input. So I assume the final result will be written there. Before we look more into it, let's quickly peek ahead. So right afterwards is another for loop. We are looping for hex C, so 12, which means we loop over 11 bytes, which would match with the size of the buffer we handled before. In the loop, it then loads a byte from the buffer that we used before, as well as the empty buffer. We assumed we'll have the result. Okay, we take a byte from each one of them and compare them. If they are correct, we stay in the loop, but if it was wrong, we set the key correct return value to 0 and break out. Okay, so that's basically a memory compare. It just compares these two buffers. This is the final check if we pass the key verification or not. This means the actual magic is happening in this obfuscated function, sjlnuahg. Let's have a look at it. Okay, this looks fairly simple on first sight. Not that many blocks and a simple loop. We see another memset and memcopy, but also a new unnamed function. So how does this look like? Oh damn, this looks pretty similar. More memset and memcopy and another loop, but this time with 2 unknown functions, PCSLWBYS and PZSMUHFR. So let's look into the first one. Okay, this one looks like a simple loop again, very similar to the memcopy or memcompare, just quite a bit more instructions inside the loop. And the other function that has a bit more going on, but also not that much. Oh, there's another unknown function hidden, but this one is also pretty short again, another loop. Okay, phew. Altogether, it's quite a bit of code. And to be honest with you, I spent quite some time trying to understand it, but I just didn't get it. I couldn't figure out what this algorithm does after several hours of staring at it. The cool thing is, we also have the same code compiled for Mac, Windows, and Linux, so you can actually look at any of those to see if maybe the compiled result is easier to understand on another system. But I have to admit, I got weak. I knew that there are write-ups out there, and I got so frustrated, and I felt really stuck, so I'm sorry, I had to look it up. So here's a write-up from EBFE. He writes, "This task is a standard KeyGanMe. Solving it would get you 500 points, which is a bit high for the difficulty." What? Too high? I'm so stuck. Why is he saying that it's much easier? Let's continue reading. "This routine takes enter DLC key as argument and return 1 if the passes all checks. The checks are the length has to be 25 chars. The alphabet is this, and there is a checksum character. So cool, we figured that out too. He also shows a cool comparison between the standard base 32 algorithm and the custom one used here. You can see how the bits are mapped. Afterwards, a function with obfuscated symbol names decrypts the custom base 32 decoded bytes. The function takes two big numbers, hex 10001 and hex 3C9921 and so forth, as arguments, and then decrypts the buffer. It is obviously a RSA decryption routine. N modulo is 90 bits, only so it can be factored in seconds. Wait, what? Obviously RSA? How is that obvious? This is exactly the information I was looking for. There's one tiny detail though that I effed up. Remember that I named this buffer 101, but the constant is actually 10001. And that constant is very common with RSA. If you have ever looked at an SSL key, it's very likely that you have seen it. I know that this is a typical public exponent, and so the only explanation I could tell myself why it is obviously RSA is that you can assume this when you see the constant hex 10001. But I was an idiot. I mistook it as 101. So maybe that's why I didn't get it. But even then, I feel like it's kind of a lucky guess or based on other experience. So I wrote EBFE on Twitter and asked him, and he confirmed that the hex 10001, 56,000 in decimal, is used often as a public key exponent. It is almost standard E value. When I see hex 10001, one can assume it's RSA scheme because this value is used so often. I kind of agree with that. Cryptographic algorithms often rely on well-known constants. For example, MD5 has some initialized buffer values that are very obvious and recognizable. So when you see these, you can assume there's MD5. He also then added that in addition to that, you can try to factor N modulo. If it has two prime factors, it's probably RSA. And so this big constant would obviously be N, and we can extract those bytes. Assemble the large number, use Python to convert it to decimal, and submit it to FactorDB. That website has a huge database of numbers, and it can tell you if a factorization is known for one. And yes, here are the prime factors for N. Essentially, now you know the RSA private key. That's why you should have much larger keys, but yeah. Theoretically, we can now enter a key again, but I'm not satisfied. I know the RSA algorithm. I know the math involved, and if I had realized that there was exponentiation or modulo exponentiation implemented here in assembler, I would have probably realized that it's RSA. So we need another video where we dig into this RSA implementation. I owe myself that.